The crisis in American high schools is brutally simple. Too few students are making strong academic gains during the high school years. For too many students, academic performance remains flat or even declines in high school, and this is especially true among the populations that are a special concern to our foundation. The result is that too few of our high school graduates are prepared for the rigors of college or the demands of competitive jobs. You've heard several people in this hearing refer to the NAEP scores that have remained essentially flat for 17-year-olds since the 1970s. Darv Winnick, chairman of NAGBE, the board that oversees NAEP, said it best. If you ask me what is the single most perplexing problem since I've gotten involved in education, that's it. The data is not only flat, but it's flat while kids are taking more math. We need to face the fact that too many students are frozen in high school. They're not graduating ready for the demands of college, work, and life. At the foundation, we've learned about this crisis from research as well as from our own work over the last 9 years. Our early investments focused on small schools, and we found some success in improving graduation rates. But much more rarely did we see the significant gains in academic performance or increases in college readiness. Our next generation strategy to radically increase the number of low-income students who graduate from college or who graduate from high school, college, and work ready has three parts based on the evidence we've gathered. The primacy of effective teaching, the importance of a common core of standards that are fewer, clearer, and higher, and the pursuit of innovative approaches that would lead to breakthrough performance. I want to comment briefly on all three. Effective teachers play the single most important role in accelerating student achievement. No other factor within our power to change has this great an impact. We can't fix this just by recruiting teachers with stronger credentials. After numerous studies, we can say with confidence that master's degrees in education, high SAT scores, high scores on certification exams, and other credentials do not predict effective teaching very well. The foundation has made a centerpiece of its strategy, increasing the number of effective teachers teaching low-income children. We're investing heavily in developing measures to determine reliably which teachers are effective and which are not. We're also researching the most promising ways of making the teachers that we have be their most effective in the classroom. As you know from your recent hearing, there's a lot of discussion about national standards these days, and those national or core standards are key to our strategy as well. But the real question is not whether standards will be local or state or national, but whether they will be focused enough on what the evidence shows is most central to student success. Everybody knows that standards is not enough. There's also a need for assessment, not just assessment for accountability, which is important, but also assessment for teaching and learning, which is what teachers need in the classroom, but which has not had nearly the same level of investment. Beyond standards and assessment, we will support the building of a spine of excellent materials to support excellent classroom work, built on technology that allows easy access and sharing of students and teachers alike. The hard part of this standards process will be making the radical leap from the vast numbers of standards states have today to a focused core that can really accelerate performance. Everyone can posture about whose standards are higher. What takes real courage is making the tough choices about the fewer things that demand students' and teachers' attention and that lead students to be college ready. The other benefit of common standards and the last piece in our strategy is that they will foster innovation across classrooms, districts, and states. With a common focused core, we can broadly share innovations that most accelerate performance in specific areas and skill sets. The evidence is clear that the combination of high schools is currently constructed and the current tools in our hands are simply not sufficient. We cannot make a leap in performance without a leap in innovation that much more directly and productively engages students and accelerate their learning. As a foundation, we will continue to fund school models that break the mold and achieve results, and next generation models that support teaching and learning that really accelerate dramatically performance. For all three elements of this strategy, we will need data systems and assessments that tell us clearly which students and which classrooms are making gains. Today, despite hundreds of millions invested in data systems and assessments, we do not have the crucial information we need. Which teachers are already effective, which are not, which teachers are becoming more effective, which teachers are teaching which kids. This progress will only be possible if we have common data standards to drive sharing of information and reduce costs. I want to end with just three quick messages that I'm most concerned to convey to this committee. We must shift our focus from credentials to demonstrated effectiveness in the classroom, from teacher quality as measured on paper to teacher effectiveness as measured by student outcomes. The Common Core of Standards must be based on evidence as to what is truly and demonstrably necessary for college work, not political or ideological turf battles. The standards must be focused enough to make mastery possible for more kids and to support teachers in developing their craft in teaching their subject. Finally, support the innovations that can demonstrate performance leaps. Be even bolder in models that break the traditions of seat time and credits, and keep your eye, as Mr. Gordon said, keep all of our eyes on the academic growth of students. When I was the State Secretary of Education in Pennsylvania, we chose to call our high school reform agenda Project 720. Given that there are roughly 180 days in a school year, in 4 years of high school, you have only 720 days to prepare students for the demands of college, work, and life. Those days and years are far too short and far more too precious to continue to waste. Thank you for giving this issue your attention.